Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Thank you. Yes. We are very happy to have Yishai Mansour here. Yishai is a force. And he has several algorithms named after him, and I think every paper I've ever written cites one of his papers. So anyway, he's going to tell us about robust probabilistic inference.
Okay, thank you very much, Adam. And I'm very glad to be here, and also very glad to be part of MSR right now. So I'm going to talk about robust probabilistic inference, and it's a joint work with Aviad, Rubinstein, and Moshe, Tennenholtz. So the first part of the talk, I would like to give you a few motivating examples. Really, what do I mean by robust, and how does robustness sort of combines with inference, and why should you care about the other part of the talk? After I finish sort of the motivating example, I'll start describing the model and go through the main results. And then hopefully we should have time to see really the algorithm and the analysis of the algorithm and what could be done. But let's sort of start with the title. So let's break the title one word at a time from right to left, like in Hebrew. So let's start with inference. So when I say inference, what I mean is mapping observation to events. So you are in a system and you observe a certain amount of things, and given those what you observe, you want to infer about things that you didn't observe. When I'm saying probabilistic, I mean that the inference, it's not that it's either zero or one, but since you're in a stochastic environment and there is an underlying probability distribution that sort of generates your observation and maps your observation to the events or the unobserved variable, the probabilistic part is talking about the stochastic. Can you see the right point? So it's mainly
batteries.
I can see it on my hand. So for the stochastic environment, for the most part of the talk, I sort of assume that we are given the joint distribution. We know what is this underlying stochastic distribution. The simplest way for me is that for you, think about your favorite Bayesian network or some other model of a joint distribution. Now, probabilistic inference is well known. It has been widely studied in computer science and in other fields. The new thing that we are bringing to the table is robustness. Robustness is the new feature that I would like to talk about. Intuitively, when I'm saying robustness, I would mean sort of being immune to corrupted inputs, right? In some sense, this is useless. What I would like to think about is that you observe certain things, but maybe what you observe is not what really happened. Okay. So let's start. I'll give three motivating examples, trying to illustrate what do I mean by robustness, how does it fit in into the framework that I would like to build. So think about spam detection. So usually spam detectors, it's not about spam this talk. Spam detectors usually sort of have various filters and are trying to detect whether an email is spam or not. They can check various things in your email. The sender, how the email is structured, what is the content, how you refer to, and usually sort of there's a bunch of various filters. And each filter is trying to detect sort of one tiny thing. And the decision at the end whether the email is spam or not is done by aggregating all those decisions upward. Okay. So you can think of an inference problem is given the observation, given what each filter sort of decides, to decide whether the email itself is spam or not. So the event that we'd like to detect is whether the email is spam or not spam. And what we observe is sort of tiny details of what each filters decides. But when you think about a spam detection, it's really more about a game. It's a game between the spammer and the spam detectors. Because once you have a good detector, then the spammer are sort of likely, and they are in practice sort of adjusting their spam in order to fool the detectors, right? So in some sense, this is a case in which there is really a game between the two sides. The spammer are really adjusting their content and are adjusting their structure to fool the detectors. And sort of, if you have a great spam detection system now and let it just run for a long time, I'm rather certain that you'll see a deterioration of quality over time, because spam will find a way to fool your detectors. Yes.
Why robust rather than strategic or adversarial as a word?
Wow. Challenging my English.
Well, it's just that robust is such a broad word, and you can be robust to a million different types of things.
I think that,
it's like,
okay,
strategic or adversarial seems, you know.
I think the next example would be more robust, like, but okay, but let's keep it in mind. Okay. So what is our goal here? So really our goal when I say robustness is our goal to still sort of classify correctly spam or not spam, or basically classify as correctly as we can, given that some of the detectors are corrupted and they're corrupted adversarially. So in this case, I think the adversarial nature is sort of fairly natural because the spammers are really adversarial. They really would like to fool our decisions. And sort of you hope that in the short run they cannot fool all the detectors, but rather only a few detectors, and you would like sort of in the short run to be able to automatically overcome them, and then hopefully sort of upgrade your detectors in the longer run. A second example is a network failure. Sort of you have a large network, sort of if you go to like any large corporation, you would see like huge rooms with an enormous number of screens and people walking around, and it's something sort of from a neck. Right.
What was that?
It's what you learned from working here.
What?
He's commenting that this is what you learned from being part of Microsoft. Okay.
And really, in a large network, in some sense, all the time something is failing. If you go to JP Morgan, they have probably something like 10,000 routers. At any point of time, a few hundreds are down. The big question for in such a setting, you would like to know two things in some sense. You would like to know sort of why is something failing. And secondly, sort of in practice, you would also like to know what is the effect. Okay, so how do usually those detection algorithms work, right? So essentially you're adding more hardware to your network in order to detect that there are failures. So you'd put on links special detectors that would observe sort of at the link level that there are errors in the bits. You'd sort of can ping various sort of components and see that they are alive and they are responding. Okay, and in some sense, since you're adding more hardware and more software, you need to ask the question, what would happen when your detectors fail? Because like everything else, they can fail also. The question is, in some sense, how would you like to model those failures? Right? So if you were a Bayesian, then you said, okay, how would I model the fact that things can fail? I need to put a prior over the failure, and given this prior, I have a regular inference problem. In some sense, it is a solution, but it's a solution that I personally do not like, because it's very hard to give a good prior to something that you don't know, right? So failure, in some sense, are unexpected. So it's true that sort of it's easy to detect when a router doesn't respond. But when you are getting something which could be reasonable from a detector and could be an error, it's very hard to decide how probable are those events. So this is why sort of we would like it to be like a worst case. And in some sense, this is a place that we'd let the adversary want to control. So again, our goal here is would be to perform good failure detections, even if a few detectors will fail, sort of. In the network literature, it would be like, you would like to overcome, let's say, a single point of failure. So if any single component would fail, you still would like to operate well. The adversarial behavior here that I will give to the corruption is more due to the fact that I would like to do a worst case modeling rather than a Bayesian modeling. I would like to say that I'm not sure how things are going to fail, but there are not going to be too many of them.
Are you thinking of the features as being, you know, wrong in training time too, or just at test time?
I think just in test time. Right.
So if this was a doctor and a patient, all their training data, all the measurements would be correct, but then when you go to diagnose a new patient,
you're taking, I'm sure, has MD5 or whatever sort of book of that the doctors have in order how to diagnose. And now sort of it tells you, measure the heartbeat, measure the blood pressure, measure this. And sort of what happens if some of the measurements are coming in wrong? Are you going to use the same decision tree, or are you going to use something else? I guess the last example was sort of in line with your example, right? So a large trend in computing is wearable and sensor computing. Hopefully, I'm not going to be around when this is how we look. We'll have a detection detector for sleeping, for blood pressure, for calories, and probably a control that decides everything for us. But more on a serious side, okay, so it is reasonable that we will have some wearable computing. It is starting, and we will have sensors for various people to detect things. And again, sort of, when you have things in the mass scale, you do expect things to fail. And if you do expect things to fail, you need to ask if the question is, all right, if I detect just a very high blood pressure, 1 to 80 or something like this, should I send the person to the emergency room? Or maybe I should do some more checks and see maybe my detector is just going wild. So again, sensors may fail. A Bayesian approach would sort of add a failure prior. But this really means that you need to somehow envision exactly how things would fail. A worst case analysis is trying to capture the fact that we don't know how they'll fail. They fail in an unpredictable way. So this relates to our worst case modeling. So I would like to think of failure as coming as an adversarial way. At the first example in the spam, it was really adversarial. Spammer really likes us to fail. In the networking example and in the sensor example, it's not that there really is an adversary. The adversarial behavior is more or less trying to model a worst case behavior. Okay. So now it's time sort of to try to describe the model and motivate it. And before I sort of I'll describe the main result that we can show. So without any failure, we have this nice picture. We'll have a single state of a world, which is going to be binary. And we will have n observable signals. We are going to keep them binary. Right? It's not critical, but it's simpler to think about it this way. Now, what we have now is we are going to have an adversary. What can the adversary do? The adversary can take the observable signal, the clean observable signal, S1 up to Sn, and the state of the system. And given those two, he can modify them to a new set of observable signals. How can he modify them? He cannot modify them arbitrarily. He has a limited number of modification rules, and he can choose one of them to do the modification. Okay? So what we are assuming is, right, that there is a limited number of modification rules that take the state of the system and the observable signals and generate what our system is going to observe as a possibly corrupted input. Right? This is a schematic picture of the model, but now let's give a more mathematical one. Right. So the state of nature is a binary state, and we are going to have n binary signals. Those are the clean signals. And given the state of nature and the signals, we have a joint distribution. We assume that we know the joint distribution. And what do I mean by know? I both mean that we can sample from it and we can compute probabilities for a given BNS. in some sense, I'm sort of assuming that the original inference problem is easy, right? Because adding robustness on top of inference cannot make the problem easier. So given the structure, we are going to have a set of observable signal. Our algorithm is just going to see the bits x1 up to xn.
B is the y? I mean,
B is the state of nature. Spam or not spam?
Yeah, so what we usually think of as y.
Okay.
Did you hear
you see, I don't want to think about it as why.
Is that what we're trying to predict?
Yes.
Okay.
Right. But think of it as an unobservable input in a Bayesian network.
Okay.
Right. Okay. So the way that we are going to model sort of the corruption is that there is a limited class of modification rules. The modification rules take the state of the system and the observable signals. And we'll assume that it can compute efficiently because we want an efficient algorithm, the mapping. And we have and we have also not too many modification rules. We'll have a polynomial number of modification rules. Okay. An example for a modification rule, for example, is take the ith bit in S and flip it, right? This is like a very simple modification rule. And now you can have, let's say, n modification rule, one for each bit. And this would say that your observed signal is one Hamming distance from the true thing.
So the modification signal rules are deterministic?
Yes.
But
I think they are deterministic and known. I think you can change them to be stochastic. Yes, it is important that they are known, right? Because otherwise, right. Or when you see the solution, you see we are very much depending on those are the modification.
I guess it seems to me like if the motivation for not taking a Bayesian approach is that you don't know the way in which things might fail. But you do know the set of modification rules.
Okay, but there is a big difference between the two. Because I'm just saying that
one of the bits is. So can you give an example of why it would be reasonable to know a modification rule?
No,
like
no.
Some example.
So let's say even with this simple modification, right? So I'm saying one of my detectors will fail, right? The adversary can cause one of my detectors to fail, but I'm not giving you probabilities. I'm not giving you the probability that this detector will fail is 0.1, the probability that this detector would fail is 0.01, and so on. Right? It's a very different setting in which a Bayesian would give you not only modification rules, but also probabilities over them.
You got your Fitbit and your 20 devices, and he's saying at most 3 of them will fail. Isn't that... Saying 3 would be counted as 20 choose 3. M would be 20 choose 3.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess it seems to me like that's a great example out of it. Like, imagine you have in your mind the model that, like, these things fail independently.
Well, he's not assuming that.
No, I know. No, I know. I know. And the thing is, it seems to me like there is some probabilistic structure in that example as an intuitive model of what's
going
on.
You could model it and say... an independent 3 will fail at random, but then that may be very poor modeling.
No,
there are correlations between what fail, and it depends on the input and everything.
But you know for certain that only 3 will? I mean, that seems a little
a
bit
much
strange.
Weaker, it seems like a much weaker assumption to say that
when you build
that
a system,
fail.
When you build a system and you would like it to be robust.
Well, I don't agree that it's a weaker assumption, because the thing is, if they're independent probabilities, there's going to be some chance that a lot fail, but not that high of a chance. Whereas in this, you're certain that only 3 will fail.
Okay, just
you know
again.
I mean, in other words, like they're strong in different ways.
You can have a modification rule that the first half flips, right? I'm not saying that it's not important that you flipped only one bit. You can flip all the bits in one of the modification rules, right? You can sort of, depending whether B is 1 or 0, you can do something very globally. I will need the number of ways that you can sort of modify the input is not growing exponentially. Okay, so our goal is, given X, predict B or Y. Okay, so what is
it's hard to predict Y given
Y. Okay. So what would be a predictor? A predictor gets as an input X, the observed signals, and he needs to predict the state of nature B. So what he does is he's defining a policy. A policy is a mapping from X to the prediction, and this policy would be probabilistic in the sense that it will output a number between 0 and 1, and we sort of interpret sort of this as a probability of predicting 0, I think. Okay. Okay, so the adversary, okay, this is a predictor. Now, what does the adversary do? So the adversary can select a modification rule, right? So we are going to model it as a game, where sort of the adversary sort of, on the one hand side, we are selecting a policy. Given our policy, the adversary can select a modification rule, and now we are sort of sampling and seeing whether we made it.
You say before X is selected, but.
Yes.
But after the nature.
But after pi is defined.
But so what about the nature? What if
nature is nature happens.
Nature.
No. So does the adversary choose what to do after the nature has made its choice?
He does his selection. Just a second.
The adversary can observe whether you have to have a heart attack or not.
No. So the adversary, okay.
Adversary is trying to predict.
No, but is the adversary, does the adversary know nature or not?
Select row I.
It's a contingent plan. Pi is a contingent plan. It modifies certain things in certain states, no?
Right. And for observe.
Row? Are you asking about row or pi? Pi. Pi is a plan that's now conditional on the signals and will modify it.
No, I'm best at adversary.
Pi is our strategy for labeling things. No?
So, and where in this?
Maybe I can help.
So where does the adversary sit?
Okay, let's go.
And where's nature? Row.
At which point is the adversary? What does the adversary see of these events?
He sees the way that we are going to predict.
But the adversary doesn't see
the realization.
Yeah, but his modification rule can depend on B.
Yeah.
So he sees
and
it.
He makes a contingent plan. So
he is allowed to depend on B. Okay.
The modification rules are allowed to depend on B.
The modification rule can say flip the seventh bit if the label is this.
Right. And this is sort of the testing. This one? I'm not sure how to resolve this. Okay. So we select pi. We are committing to a policy.
Can you write it behind the screen?
Then the adversary selects a modification rule. And now sort of things happen to test us, right? Testing us means that at random from the distribution we select B and S. And then X is defined through the modification rule that can depend on both on B and S. And then our prediction is, I'm not going to write the next line. So really the question is whether pi of X is equal to B. Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. So when you think about it this way, it's really a zero-sum game. It's a zero-sum game between our algorithm and the adversary. So we are trying to minimize the error. The adversary would try to maximize our error, right? So if we fix a policy and a specific modification rule, the error is what you expect, right? It's on average over all the states of the world, the probability that we make an error. The optimal min-max error is you take the best policy, and for the best policy, you're taking the worst modification rule. Fine. And when I'll say later epsilon optimal, I mean that it's at most epsilon from this.
So this is where the kind of you assume essentially that the training data has no corruptions because you assume that the algorithm only knows the underlying distribution over x.
So what am I assuming? I'm assuming that the algorithm knows the true underlying distribution of b.
If you had training data, that would essentially be uncorrupted.
Yes.
Or whatever.
Okay. What is the main result? The main result is a polynomial time randomized algorithm that, given the observable signals, computes a prediction for the state of the world, and its error probability is almost as good as you can hope. It's the value of a game plus an epsilon, which can be arbitrarily small. Okay. So how can you use such a theorem? Okay. So one thing is the way that I gave all my examples, right? You can think of it that you really have some underlying distribution, some Bayesian networks. Yes.
So in this model, there is also a sort of a zeroth step where rho 1 to rho m are specified, right?
Oh, okay. So zero step is right. Rho 1 up to rho m
and the
distribution. B over b and s are specified.
And distribution is right. Okay, good.
Right. So one simple corollary is sort of think of a Bayesian network in which you would like sort of to learn an unobserved variable, and part of your observation can be corrupted. This is sort of my motivating example. Here is another sort of motivating example. Think that rather than having corruption, there is no corruption. But rather you have, let's say, five different models of how the data could be generated, right? Now, for simplicity, let's assume that they are Bayesian trees. And now, in some sense, you'd like to minimize your error in the worst case over the model, right? So it's essentially the same question, right? There is no corruption here for motivation, but really the corruption is coming from the fact that you are unsure which of the three sort of generated the data. Okay, as a remark, a modification rule also can depend on the input itself. For example, flip the jth bit, which is one. It really will flip for every input a different kind of bit. Okay. So this is a theory motivating example rather than the applied ones. So think of noisy independent experts, simply just coins. So each expert has a bias. And the probability that its signal is equal to the true state of the world is a half plus lambda I, right? So each one of the experts is biased towards the right coin. Each one of them is biased differently, okay? If there is no adversary, then this is a very simple case. We can solve it using, let's say, a naive Bayes. We will get that the optimal prediction is a linear predictor, and the linear predictor will have weights which are proportional to the log odds ratio, right? So all this you can sort of show fairly easily, and it's well known. What would happen in our setting, right? So in fact, this was the example that we started with, right? So think about a modification rule that allows you to flip one bit, right? So if you're sort of solving it this way, then, for example, if one of the experts is perfect, it will have an infinite weight, but then the adversary can flip its value. Okay. So if the adversary is going to flip the highest value, well, maybe we can ignore the highest value. But if we ignore the highest value, the adversary will know that we are ignoring it and will sort of bug some other way. This is a zero-sum game, essentially. Because we are on the one hand side trying to make the weight such that we are not going to be hurt by any single weight being flipped. And the other side is having a mixed strategy that, on the other hand, would like to cause us as much damage as it can. Okay. Just as a side remark, okay, while we'll be talking about doing optimally, remember that sometimes the optimal is not very good. For example, if you have two perfect experts, and the adversary can choose one at random and flips it, it's clear that this setting will have a very high error rate, exactly one half, regardless of what we do. So although we will have the optimal error rate, the optimal error rate can be high, just as a side remark. Okay. So let's start with sort of giving a solution for, first of all, exact solution, which will be an exponential size linear program. Later, we will sort of try to convert it to a polynomial size one. So for each state of nature, and each modification rule, and each possible observation, and what we'll do is we'll compute the probability of the observation. Right. And computing this probability, sort of we can use sort of inference of the underlying problem. And for each modification rule and each possible prediction, we can compute its aggregate error. And what we would like is to minimize the error in the worst case. So for each modification rule, we can compute its error. And now we sort of would like to minimize the maximum of those values. And the output, okay. What is going to be the output of this program? The output is per observation, it's like a huge table, per observation, a number between 0 and 1. Okay. Okay. I'm going to develop this program slightly more because this is going to be the basis of what I'm going to show later in order to how to go from the exponential to the polynomial size. So let's do it in slightly more detail. So really what we have is a policy. A policy is a mapping from variable to probabilities. Somehow, for some reason, the probability of predicting zero. Okay? Now we have a set of constants. What are those constants? Those constants are the following. We'll call it A, X, B, and rho. This is the probability of observing X if the true nature of the world is B, little b, and the adversary uses rho, right? So essentially, this is the probability of having this state of the world and this modification rule equals x. Okay, how can we compute it? Okay, so it's one of two things. We can compute it explicitly if the inverse of the rho is bounded, or we can compute it using an inference algorithm. It's sort of what I alluded before. In some sense, this is what I said. We are assuming that the underlying probability is nice in the fact that we can compute, we can sample it, and we can compute inference with respect to it. So for now on, assume that I can compute those constants. Right. So now I needed to define the error. Right. So what is the error? The error is the error when I predict 1, when I predict 0 and the true thing is 1, and when I predict 1 and the true thing is 0. That's an error, right? So I'm summing up now all the errors for a specific modification rules. And given this, now I can write a very simple linear program. So I'd like to minimize the error over all the predictions. So I'm taking the maximum error over all my prediction rule. And I need also to make sure that So I need to make sure that my predictions are between 0 and 1, right? And this is sort of, would be sort of, strange enough, this constraint is going to be the painful one. Because this constraint has an exponential number of constraints, right? And also, the Q includes the exponential number of variables, right? So in some sense, right, I'm going to do formally the primal and dual in the next slide, but this says that both the primal and dual are going to be exponential size. Okay. Just sort of recapping, even more formally. So we have a probability that the state of the world is zero. Those are the constants that we are computing. The constants are simply the probability that we are in a certain state of a world and we observe X, assuming a very specific modification rule. What we'll really care about is the difference between those two. Right? In some sense, if delta A is zero, for example, we cannot do anything, right? Okay. So the primal program, what it does, it tries to minimize the error, and per modification rule, you have this thing. This is identical to what we had in the previous slide, right? You are going over all the axes, And then you're computing your qx times the delta between those two things. Okay. The dual program, okay, the dual program is choosing a this question.
I can save it for the end of the slide.
Okay. Okay. The dual program is really sort of selecting a distribution over the modification rules. And given this distribution over the modification rules, right, what it does is it computes sort of, I'm not sure how to call this. So what you would like is per x, you're having a quantity. And what you would like is sort of to minimize those quantities, because you're going to later be subtracting them. So really what you're doing is selecting a distribution over the modification rule and optimizing this quantity. Yes, well.
I never divorce a primal from its dual, which is why I waited. So,
okay.
your loss function is
that way
just the probability of error, so it's a, your loss function is probability of error, so,
yes.
So it's a linear function, so among the set of optimal policies pi, there is always a deterministic predictor that is optimal.
Not sure. So it's the absolute value.
I mean, I could...
Okay, I trust you. I didn't think about it.
Let me try to convince you, actually.
So okay. Okay.
Take a probabilistic... Take a pi that outputs probability distributions and convert it into a deterministic one by just applying a threshold theta. If the predicted probability of zero is above theta,
okay.
I predict zero, and otherwise I predict one.
Okay.
If theta is uniformly random between zero and one, the behavior of that
okay.
policy is exactly the same as your pi.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, sorry, the
okay.
probability of incorrect prediction is exactly the same. So it follows that for at least one choice of theta,
okay.
that deterministic thresholding rule gives
okay.
an error rate which is as good as the...
Okay.
I mean, I don't know, unless I messed up on a definition.
Okay.
My question was going to be, assuming it's correct that there is an
okay.
optimal policy that's deterministic, you could instead have had a primal LP which had just had doubly exponentially many variables, namely the algorithm designer's probability of choosing each deterministic policy. And the gain is that the dual now has a polynomial number of variables, which is just the adversary.
How did you get the polynomial?
So like in your zero-sum game between the algorithm and the
right.
adversary, I'm limiting the algorithm to deterministic policies, so now it has a doubly exponential but finite strategy set. And now I'm just thinking of the LP that writes down the saddle point of that zero-sum game, and since the adversary has only polynomial number of strategies, at least I've got...
Let's take it offline. I'm not
okay,
sure.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So this is the dual from the previous slide. And really sort of an easier way to think about this dual is think that per x, what we are really doing, we are taking the maximum between 0 and this linear function. And sort of we are summing those. So we are choosing a distribution over the modification rule. And we are sort of maximizing this quantity, which is really minimizing this sum. So we would really like those to be zeros. And this is a sort of our simplified dual program. OK. So what does the exact optimal exponential linear program give us? OK. So the solution is exponential. Sort of the number of variables, at least the way that I wrote it, is exponential. Applying an observation to a prediction. So it's a mapping from observation to prediction. The number of constraints is also exponential because you need to keep the prediction between 0 and 1. Right? So in this way, both the primal and the dual are exponential. And what we need to do in order to write this exponential program is we need to compute those constants. Those constants were the probability of observing a certain x if the adversary used a certain modification rule, and the true state of nature was something. Okay. 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 So now let's show how can we go from an exponential size to a polynomial size. So So the observation is that most of the constraints are just saying that Q of X is between 0 and 1, right? So it's a restriction of the prediction to be between 0 and 1. So what we'll do is we are going to sample the observable signal. Okay, so given what we'll build, rather than building the entire exponential size linear program, we are going just to sample it. And using a sample, we are going to solve this sample. So we're going to build a linear program that includes the constraints that are in our sample. We are going to ignore all the other things which are not in our sample. And we'll need sort of to scale things that things would be unbiased, sort of like an important sampling. And now after we sample, we have a polynomial size linear program, and we can solve this polynomial size linear program. And what we'll show is that the average solution is, what we need to show is that the average solution for this linear program is an approximately optimal policy. So this is the plan of what we would like to do. Yes?
I understand. So the access you have to this distribution is that you can evaluate it. You can evaluate conditional probabilities.
So I'm assuming that I can sample from it. Right. I'll need it here.
Right.
And essentially, I'm assuming that I can do inference for it. Inference is like computing the constant.
And you can do reverse after they did the
modification.
So you don't need to be able to. Because on the previous slide, you said you could.
So the question is how to compute those constants.
You could say, what's the chance that it was this x given that they did this modification?
Right. So I need to compute the probability that I'll observe x given that the modification rule is rho I,
Subtle, because like if the modification rule takes everything and collapses, sometimes makes it all zero or something.
But then you need to say solve that problem anyway, because the adversary might just decide to use rho I, and he'll tell you that he's using rho I.
Yeah.
And if you can't solve the inference problem now, then you shouldn't be able to solve the robust.
Okay, thanks. Okay, good. Thanks.
So what do we need to do for, then this is sort of what we are sort of going to see. What we need to do sort of, we are going to rather than solving the exponential size linear program, we are going to sample it and solve a sampled linear program. So we need to relate the original linear program to the sample linear program. We need to do two things. First of all, feasibility. So consider the expected value of the solution, and we'll show that this is feasible. So basically, in expectation, the solution that we get is feasible. Feasibility is sort of like a very, minimalistic requirement, because just predicting zero every time is feasible, right? Of course, the interesting thing is bounding the quality, right? So we want to bound the error rate. In order to bound the error rate, we'll be using the dual linear program. And the dual linear program is the one that was really going to tell us that the difference between the sampled linear program and the exponential size linear program are not too far apart. And finally, sort of, we'll have a fairly standard high probability generalization bound. Essentially, we'll be talking all the time about expectation. Then at the end, we'll just need to sample it a few times and sort of argue that if you average enough samples, then the average is very near to its expectation. This would be the fairly standard generalization bound. Okay, so this is sort of a time just to give a high-level specification. How does the policy look like? Right? We are going to observe x. This is our input. Given our input, we are going to take a sample of additional observable signal given some distribution mu. The distribution mu is independent from x, technically. So we are going to sample IID from this distribution mu, a polynomial number of samples. I'm not defining mu now. I'll define it later. Now we have a sample t, and we'll add x to t. This is going to be in t. Now we can compute a linear program for t. We get the solution for the linear program for each one of the inputs in t, but we are interested only in x. So we record the solution for x, and then we do this many times and average what kind of solutions we got for x. And the average that we are getting over many trials is our prediction. And the theorem we would say is that the policy that I defined, right, this is a randomized policy. It randomized because it samples here things, maps an observed signal to the prediction in polynomial time, because we are going to have the set T is going to be polynomial size. And so the running time is polynomial, and it's epsilon optimal. So its error probability is like the value of the zero sum game that I defined, plus epsilon, which comes due to the sampling errors that we will have here. Okay. So now when we need, let's specify the linear program more exactly, right? There's going to be some distribution mu. I'm trying to defer it as much as I can to defining it. But how are we going to build the set T? We're going to start with the point X. This is the point we need to predict, and add points to it. Given the set T, we can now write the linear program. So the linear program is the same linear program as before. The main difference is this factor. This factor is really for normalization. It's like for important sampling. It's making sure that we have an unbiased estimator. So the number of z in t is the number of occurrence of the vector z in the set t. So if you think about the expected value of this, it's exactly one, right? When you average over the t, for any z, its expectation, you multiply it by mu z. This will cancel out. Now you're averaging over t. This will cancel out, and you're getting just one. This is just verifying that you have an unbiased estimator here. Right. So we'll be interested in two quantities. One of them is the expected error. This is this guy. And one is sort of the expected prediction. The expected prediction is sort of when I'm taking an x and averaging it in expectation over t, what is my average x? Okay? So this is clearly feasible. That's easy. So this is not clearly between 0 and 1. But what you need to realize is that since this is 1, you can show that this is equal to this. And therefore, it's bounded by 1. So what this slide just showed is that when I'm writing the sample LP, if I look at the expected value of the policy and expected value of error, they are both a feasible solution to the original primal program. Okay. Okay. So now, okay. Okay. So this is what I said. Okay. So now let's look at what would happen when we look at the dual of this program, okay? So trust me, this is the same dual as before. The only difference is that we added these normalization factors here. And now, just to recall, the R was sort of the maximum between 0 and this linear function. And therefore, when you take expectation of this, you're just getting the sum of the Rs, right? So this is like an unbiased estimate. What is going to be the effect of sampling? The effect of sampling would mean that on the average, we sort of will increase the objective. This is due to the overfitting. How much are we going to increase it? This would be sort of due to the variability between the t's, right? So it will depend on the variance. The variance will really depend on the coefficients, namely on those guys, right? So of course, like this is bounded by 1, right? Because this is less than t. So really what we need to bound the ratio between r, this thing, and mu of z. Fortunately, I didn't define mu yet. So I'm going to define mu such that this ratio is going to be bounded. Mm-hmm. Okay. So now let's fix the okay, so how are we going to pick the distribution mu? Okay, so we want to bound the variance. So we want to keep the coefficient small. So if we just choose them uniformly, you're going to get very large coefficients. This wouldn't work. But here is a distribution that would work, right? So just recall that the way that R is defined is sort of, it's a summing over, this is a difference of two A's. So what we are going to do is take the distribution, which will be the sum of the two A's, and then just to make it a distribution, divide by M, right? So this is a valid distribution. Sampling from it is very easy. Just take a random B and S from the distribution of nature, select a random modification rule, and apply it, right? So we can sample very easily mu. Okay. So what the why does it do the trick? Okay, so we want to bound R over mu, right? How large can R be? So those things are difference between two A's. So the most that it could be is the maximum of those values. So this is the maximum difference. Here we have the sum of them, right? So of course the sum is bigger than the difference, but we do have this extra factor of M. So point-wise, all those coefficients are less than M, right? So this means that the coefficients that we are getting are bounded as a function of our parameter, M. M is the number of modification rules. So just sort of trying to complete the proof. So what we need to show is that the average, the expected error when we are doing the sampling is bounded by the optimal error plus epsilon, assuming that T is large enough. But T is enough to be polynomial in M, N, and 1 over epsilon. So essentially, thinking from the duality, the optimal error is this, right? And when we are doing sampling, this is sort of the average sample thing. So they look almost the same. Essentially, you can think that of this as sampling of this. So we need to bound the difference between those two values. And what we are doing a concentration bound. What was the main thing that we have? We know that those coefficients are bounded. We know that those things cannot be larger than M. I'm not going to do the details of the concentration bound here, but the main thing is to bound the coefficient. Once the coefficients are bounded, you can sort of do the regular generalization bound, do a union bound over an epsilon net, and then get a bound on how large T should be. Okay, trying to put everything together back again. Okay, so how does our algorithm look like? Given an observed signal, we sample a bunch of additional random signals. We set the resulting LP, including this said T. We solve it and record the prediction. We need to average it many times because we want to estimate the expected policy rather than the a sampled one. We average it many times, and this is our prediction. Questions? Okay. So the main new feature of what I talked today is robustness, and I think it's both an important issue, both in practice and in theory. And for the same reason, somehow our ability sort of to say that what we observe may be different than what happened, and may be different in an unpredictable way, this was the main thing of this talk. The other thing is I think that inference and robustness go well together. When you're doing inference, you want to infer something about sort of an unobservable state. But robustness also gives you the ability to say that maybe what you sort of observe is not exactly what you observe. Essentially, in practice, I think systems are doing it implicitly. When you build a real system, you would like it to be robust. I'm sure you're not building a proof with a zero-sum game, but you'd like to see that sort of, when the observations are not what you expect, the system doesn't break down. I'm sure that anyone who builds a real system does it implicitly and maybe even explicitly. Okay, just sort of a few challenges. Right. So one thing that we are not able to handle here is the number of modification rules. It sort of, for the solution at least that we have, it seems inherent that we need it to be polynomial in everything that was sort of we are doing. On a different note, I think sort of this modeling of robustness with modification rule could be applied at many, in many other cases. So it gives a different way of talking about two distribution or two things being different. We are used to talking about them in a statistical distance. This is somehow giving like an operation way of sort of talking about when two distributions are different from each other. And I think with this note, I'm going to wrap up. you choose.
So just the exponential number of modification rules, can you not handle it because you don't know what the information theory says? Or is it just that you don't know how to do it computationally efficiently?
Okay, if it's really exponential, then I think it should be hopeless because then I can, at some point, if you have too many modification rules, you can translate everything to everything else. Right. So I'm not sure.
Like you can apply
an exponential number, but not all exponential numbers.
Right. Yeah. So, but our solution is inherently building around the fact that you need a bounded one.
But do you know the answer to just a sample complexity kind of equivalent, right? I mean, do you really need to know a lot of information here, or is it just that your algorithm and it's a computational?
I'm not sure about that. Okay, fair enough.
There's a very classical problem in like econometrics and possibly in statistics about like error and variables models. Usually those models are cases where you think there might be mistakes and you're learning the like regression model. Here you sort of know the regression model, but then you get a series of X variables with errors. It seems like someone in statistics, in classical statistics, which would be worried about this sort of worst case thing and not a like basic statistics, must have looked at that case, no?
Okay, so usually in statistics, when they talk about robustness, they mean something sort of else. They don't mean really worst case over this. They usually sort of assuming a specific sort of model of corruption and analyze with respect to this. Could be jumps in the
story. No. There's actually these robust statistics where you, you want to get a mean correctly, and you want to be robust to any modification of a particular data point. So
there's a huge amount of stuff on that in econometrics.
It's kind of like the very similar differential privacy kinds of things that you want to be like arbitrarily robust to point perturbations in your data. And there are
okay. Okay, but this is sort of different than sort of the prediction here.
Sort of.
No, it just seems like the problem I can think of in economics that's most closely related to this sort of thing.
How does this relate to smooth analysis, which is also like half worst case, half average case, very distributional?
I think it has more of a distributional flavor, right? It's not that, right, okay. I think it's different between saying that all the variables might have a small perturbation rather than saying a small set of variables can have huge perturbation. I'm not saying which one is better even, right? But it's different.
I think one thing that you would do, which is also quite common in coding theory, is the smooth analysis sort of flips steps 3 and 2, I think, 2 and 3.
Yes.
You look at the sample, then you say, what modification do I want to do?
This could be done, I think, also here. Also, yeah. Right. We didn't think about it, but I got this comment more than once. Okay, yes.
Do you have any results on how the error star value degrades
okay.
as more powerful?
Right. So in the case of, a noisy independent expert, we didn't really analyze it in that way. I can give you like a few sample points which are easy, right? If more or less, an extreme case, if you have all the biases are identical, it's very clear that you should use a majority rule. right, robust or not robust. What can the adversary do? He can flip one of them, and then he's not going to gain much. What I'm not sure there, right, and if all the biases are sort of somehow homogeneous, a similar solution would work. What I'm not sure is what would happen when you get like an exponential curve, right? And I hope to work it out, but this is my best answer.
Great, thanks very much.